please all rise for a moment of silence and pledge to the flag. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Here.
Turnbull?
Here.
Amo?
Here.
Anagnostakis?
Present.
Benton?
Here.
Berkman?
Right here.
Benelli?
Here.
Cheney?
Here.
Dillard? Salvo?
Present.
Ickes?
Here.
Fagione?
Here.
Hines?
Here.
Chemnitz?
Here.
Corsick?
Here.
O'Donnell?
Here.
Paduk?
Here.
Ruskevich?
Here.
Sullivan?
Here.
Biro?
Here.
Brescia?
Here.
20 present, 1 absent.
Okay, I'd like to invite up Wayne Booth, Deputy County Exec, for a presentation, along with Sean Giroux from the Cultural Equity Task Force, who is the co-chair, for No Name Calling Week.
It is a lengthy proclamation. This is for No Name Calling Week. And whereas name calling and bullying are pervasive in our schools, and whereas the National Institute of Child Health and Human Development study of public, private, and parochial school students in grades 6 through 10 found that almost a third of the 6th to 10th graders, which equates to 5.7 million children nationwide, have experienced some kind of bullying, and now, therefore, it be resolved that I, Stephen M. Newhouse, Orange County Executive in the State of New York, and L. Stephen Brescia, Chairman of the State Legislature, do hereby proclaim January 16th through 20th, 2017, as No Name Calling Week in Orange County, and call upon the teachers, students, parents, and school officials, particularly those working with grades 5 through 8, to appropriately observe the week through activities, lessons, programs designed to reduce name calling and bullying on the basis of body size, ethnicity, gender identification or expression, physical or mental ability, race, religion, sexual orientation, social or academic standing, or any other attribute for which students are singled out for such unacceptable behavior. Honored this second day of February 2017, signed Stephen M. Newhouse and L. Stephen Brescia, Chairman.
Just on behalf of the Cultural Equity Task Force, as the co-chair with myself and Elise Gold, we just want to thank the Orange County Legislature, County Exec Newhouse, for your continued support of No Name Calling Week. We find it to really be an inspiration that it's not just something that happens in schools, but the whole county is behind it. We will also share this proclamation with our partners in Ulster and Dutchess County at the Roosevelt Library at the event that we're having in March, where it's an artistic event of different students from different school districts from, you know, multiple counties that come together. So again, thank you for your support. Appreciate it.
Okay, regular public participation. We have Dan Burke from Monroe regarding ways and means, item number 14.
That's the 14 items, and it's more to do with the composition of the Ways and Means Committee.
because in Washington, Steve Bannon told the media to shut their mouths. Well, here in Orange County, the chairman of the legislature does not appoint two Democrats to that committee because they ask too many questions. In effect,
Yeah, this isn't an agenda item, correct?
Right.
Okay, Dan, you're going to have to wait until the end of the agenda.
Okay.
Okay.
I'll see you then.
Sorry about that. Okay, Jerry Kleiner. Agenda item number one.
Thank you.
This is, oh, okay, it's not pulled yet.
It's still on the agenda?
Yeah, it's going to come off the agenda, but you can speak to it. Go ahead.
Okay. It's, you know, it's a very exciting find in Orange County, if I understand it correctly. And I'm just not certain on exactly what's being done and how it's being done. And so my comment really, I guess then this becomes an end of the meeting comment, because my comment was I was more comfortable in understanding it when my representative was on the committee. And I think this is where he was asking a lot of questions and he knew nothing about my saying this. So that's my concern with this particular issue. Thank you.
Majority Leader Bonasek.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I move to approve the minutes of November 14th, December 1st, and December 22nd of 2016, and January 5th, 2017.
Second.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried. Any consents or withdrawals? Majority Leader, or Legislator Fagione.
Chairman, thank you. I request that item number one on the agenda, bond resolution authorizing the preservation of historic records in the county's clerk's office, stating that the estimate maximum cost thereof is $125,000, appropriating said amount therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $125,000 bonds of the county to finance said appropriation be withdrawn and referred to the Ways and Means Committee.
Second.
Okay, if there's no objections, that will be done. Okay, yes, Majority Leader Bonasek.
Thank you. I request consent to place on the agenda a resolution of the Orange County Legislature opposing commuted prison life sentence of Brinks terrorist Judith Clark.
Second.
Okay. Okay. One objection? Okay, roll call on the objection to put it on the agenda?
No, point of order.
Put it on the agenda.
Okay.
Point of order, they can be
discussion.
One per legislative.
Okay. Yep. Okay. Any discussion?
Yes.
Legislator Ricas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, we've had a tough start to this current year, and as a legislature, and in cooperation. We saw that at the last meeting. And as our elected chair, I take everything that you say to heart. And one of the things that you were very emphatic about was that we do away with consent resolutions. That all resolutions that folks wanted to come through this legislature should go through the committee process. Now, I don't see, and I've looked, and there really is no time essence to this particular thing, this resolution which is being presented, and I would like to see it go through, for discussion by all of us, the committee process. And it's the right thing to do. I think you started off with the right words after you were elected chairman last month, that, you know, we need to not get political in this whole situation. And I think this is deviating even farther and not going to lead to what we need to do, which is all of us working together. And one of the things is going through committees with these resolutions. So that's why I'm asking, and I objected to this particular resolution. I'm not into the content of it, I'm into the process of it. So that's my argument about it.
Legislator Anagnostakis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. While I agree with my colleague, Mr. Ickes, as to what he just said, the problem is what I've argued here many times over the last 3 and 4 years, that once we break a precedent and we set a new one, then we have to live by that from then on. Over the last 2 and 3 years, there have been multiple people that said we should not have consent resolutions, but once the door was opened and the horse was out of the barn, it's been done over and over, at least 2 or 3 times, as far as I know, over the last 2 or 3 years. That null and voids the correct comments of Mr. Ickes. So again, we've had other things that we've done as a legislative body where we broke precedent. And once we break it, I don't want to hear 3 years later, we can't do that when we did do it 3 years before. So my point to this is, yes, Mr. Ickes, you're right. We shouldn't have been doing this, but we've been doing this for the last 2 and 3 years. We've been putting consent resolutions on. So as far as I'm concerned, it's fair game. People have to decide, do they want this on the agenda today or do they not want it on the agenda today? Thank you.
Okay, a yes vote would be to put it on the agenda, correct? And a no vote would be to not. And I just have to correct Legislator Ickes. I never said that no consent resolution should come to the floor. I said I didn't agree with it, the process, especially memorializations, but there are always gonna be consents. And this one, just like the one that Legislator Hines brought last month with respect to Cornwall Hospital closing, there's urgency to this request. So that's why I brought it forward. And I would have brought it forth at rules and put it on the rules agenda, but I read the article in the Times Herald Record, and that's what got me fired up. And that's why I brought it to public safety. So everybody's had ample time to absorb this in the last 2 weeks. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
No.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis?
Yes.
Benton?
Yes.
Berkman? Vannelli?
Yes.
Cheney?
Yes.
DeSalvo?
Yes.
Ickes?
No.
Fagione?
Yes.
Hines?
Yes.
Chemnitz?
Yes.
Kulisek?
Yes.
O'Donnell?
Yes.
Paduk?
Yes.
Ryskevich?
Yes.
Sullivan?
Yes.
Vero?
Yes.
Brescia?
Yes.
17 ayes, 3 noes.
And we do have 2 speakers to speak on this agenda item now that's on the agenda. Sheriff Carl DeBois would be the first speaker, and Dan Dollinger, Police Chiefs Association of Orange County. And before they speak, I just have to thank Chief Dominic Blasco. I texted him the other day and asked him to come, and I thank you for your diligent work in helping bring Justice Space killers to justice. You worked with the Sheriff's Office, the District Attorney, the State Troopers. Took about a year, but you. Hopefully that's the guy that you caught. And I thank you for your diligence on that. Thanks for coming today. Sheriff, Sheriff's Office, I said it right too.
Thank you for allowing me to speak today. I went to the police academy in Rockland County, and I went to the police academy with a person by the name of Alan Colsey, who back in 1981 was the chief of South Nyack Police Department in Rockland County. I just want to read some excerpts of his account of October 20th, 1981, the day of the Brinks armored truck robbery. October 20th, 1981, it was a crisp autumn afternoon, sweater weather. Police radio's frequencies drone endlessly. Then this message. To all cars in station, an armed robbery of an armored truck just occurred at the Nanuet Mall in the last few minutes. Vehicle described as a red van with a sunroof. That is a red van with a sunroof. Last seen headed onto Middletown Road, no direction, no further information at this time. Supposedly 2 armored guards have been shot. Armed robbery, authority, Clarkstown PD. The time is 3:56. Allen headed out of his office to join other officers already moving to key locations. More information on the radio. The suspects have switched vehicles, are now believed to be operating a yellow Honda Accord and a U-Haul truck headed toward Route 59. Nyack police officers approached the New York State Thruway entrance at Mountain View Avenue and Route 59. Officers direct the placement of the patrol units to prevent entry to the southbound Thruway. And then the desk officer advises that they are going to stop a U-Haul truck for investigation. The time is now 4 p.m. Comes over the radio, the chilling news that brings a nervous shudder. We have a report that cars are supposedly involved in a shooting with a U-Haul truck at Waldron and Route 59. Shots fired, possibly automatic weapons. Then radio traffic reports the very worst, directly from the scene. We've got two officers shot up here, Mountain View Avenue. The police radio crackles with more information as it comes in. Automatic weapons, definitely automatic weapons. The suspects are fleeing up the hill onto Mountain Avenue in a large white Buick. Allen flies north on 9W to Route 59 to approach the site of the shootings. Utter chaos everywhere I look. People are running. An ambulance on the way to Nyack Hospital is being commandeered to transport the mortally wounded officers. In that instant, Allen decided the only thing he could do was position himself as they attempted to make their escape toward Christian Harold Road. As he guessed it, he was right. On Christian Harold Road, he sees the yellow Honda Accord speeding toward him in the opposite direction, traveling east back toward Nyack with three occupants inside. He drives to a nearby driveway to turn around, and right behind him comes the white Buick. Two cars, at least six suspects. In the midst of all the chaos and confusion already on the radio, he reports his situation to the desk at Nyack PD. Direction of travel, descriptions, license plate numbers, etc. While cutting across 9W south on Midland Avenue at 80 miles an hour, passing cars right and left. The traffic light is turning red for Midland Avenue at the intersection of 5th. Suddenly, the two suspect vehicles turn down 6th Avenue, avoiding the traffic light. Cars slide, tires spin, gravel flies in all directions. Now they're heading back into the congestion of the center of town. The long hill on 6th Avenue comes to an end at the bottom of a T with Broadway. It can only be left or right into town. The Buick, having passed the Honda on Midland Avenue, is now in the lead. The worst, it turns right going south on Broadway into Nyack. I begin to slow coming down the hill behind the Honda, continuing the pursuit. The Honda then skids across Broadway into a concrete wall. He slows to a stop and waits. He's back 30 yards or so behind them, watching to see if the Honda will continue to attempt escape or if the Buick will return, possibly coming up behind him. Nothing. He turns the front wheels and the engine block in a direct line of cover and defense between me, or between him and the Honda. He requests backup and exits the driver's door onto his knees, staying low and drawing his service revolver across the hood of the car, aimed at the immobile Honda and its occupants. The time is 4:11 p.m. You know, they hit the wall too hard. The Honda wouldn't move. A person now known to me as Judith Clark opens up the passenger door and puts her feet on the pavement while remaining seated in the car. She's trying to reach behind her seat to get at something on the rear floor. Another person now known to me as David Gilbert exits the driver's side and begins to walk slowly back to my direction. I yell at him to get away from the car, keep their hands up where he can see them. Clark ignores the orders, and Gilbert tells me that he needs my help because his friends have been hurt in the accident. Meanwhile, Clark continues to search behind and around her seat. Pedestrians begin to approach the crashed car to render assistance. Allen yells to stay away from the car. Unknown at the time to these civilians or to him, that is, Gilbert is trying to distract him on one side while waiting for the backseat occupant, Samuel Brown, to open fire. But Brown has been too badly injured in the crash and is out of action. That leaves Judith Clark to frantically search for the loaded 9mm semi-automatic that has fallen out of Brown's hands onto the back floor of the Honda. Allen calls for more radios, calls on the radio to request more assistance. Again, dispatch answers. Officers have left the police station and are trying to cut the white Buick on its way south on Broadway. He tells radio dispatch he has two suspects at gunpoint and likely a third. He orders any available units to respond to my location. Orangetown police officer Michael Seidel does, 12-gauge shotgun in hand. Alan was very appreciative. I'm not going to say what he said, but he was very appreciative. The time is 4:15 p.m. Additional units arrive at 6th and Broadway. We're able to take control of the scene and make the necessary arrest of the three suspects. The 9mm pistol is secured from the back of the Honda, and we carefully approach the trunk to further investigate. No more suspects, only green bank bags. Inside the bags, we discover the proceeds of the robbery. $1.3 million from the armored truck, probably to buy guns, ammo, and explosives to further their cause. We get news from the hospital. Chip Brown is dead, and that Eddie O'Grady is fighting for his life. As it was, he died also. If you read Governor Cuomo's media release, he praised Judith Clark for attaining college degrees, being community-minded, and helping fellow inmates. I'm glad she's found her calling in life. What you didn't read was about the three families who lost a father, a husband, a son, or brother that day. The families that would never enjoy Christmas, birthday, holiday with their loved ones. Nothing about walking a daughter down the aisle or grandchildren who would never know their grandfather. When Alan Colsey confronted Judith Clark and her fellow terrorists that day, she was trying to find a gun that was somewhere in the back seat of that car. If she found it, there is no doubt in my mind, she would have pulled the trigger. Alan and the other officers are lucky she didn't find it. Governor Cuomo's decision to commute the sentence of Judith Clark is an act of dishonor to the families, law enforcement, Judge David Ritter, an Orange County resident, prosecutors, and our communities. Governor Cuomo thinks she is deserving. She's deserving of this, to stay in prison. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheriff. Thank you, Lieutenant Arteta, too, for coming from the Sheriff's Office. And Alex Jamison, Supervisor Chester, is here as well. Okay, Chief Dollinger.
Thank you, Chairman Brescia, and the members of the Orange County Legislature for the opportunity to address you today. You just heard from the sheriff. He's got some very personal experiences with this incident. He knows some of the people that were involved. Unlike him, I don't have any personal experience with the incident. I don't know anybody who was involved. I was still in grade school when it happened. I say the same for many of the members of my association. However, I and some members of my association are here today because we do still feel very deeply about this issue. I had the opportunity to speak with some of the members of my association prior to speaking today. I feel confident saying that as an association, several emotions were brought up. We were saddened, we were frustrated, we were angered by Governor Cuomo's decision to commute the sentence of Judith Clark. Judith Clark is a convicted killer. She was sentenced to 75 years to life in prison. She was convicted of first-degree robbery, three counts of second-degree murder, deaths of Police Officer Nyack, Police Officer Waverly Brown, and Sergeant Edward O'Grady, as well as Brinks Armored Car Guard Peter Page, and it should also be noted that Brinks Guard Joseph Trombino was also seriously injured in this incident. The actions of Judith Clark took place while she was acting on behalf of a terrorist organization, allegedly to further their radical activities to construct the Republic of New Africa. The terrorist organization was Weather Underground. Recent actions to commute the sentence to less than half of the minimum 75 years in prison, which was lawfully imposed by a judge here in our own Orange County court, are a slap in the face to everyone in the law enforcement profession. Two police officers lost their lives in the line of duty during this event, in which she was undisputably an active participant. With increasing frequency, our society seems to be forgetting that police officers are people too. Our profession, the members of our profession, are beginning to feel like we are less valuable than other members of society because of the career choice that we've made. While we all recognize that we've accepted an increased risk to our personal safety by our choice to be law enforcement officers, none of us want to be seen as disposable members of society either. This action makes us feel further in that effect. We all have families and friends. Officer Brown, Sergeant Edward O'Grady, left behind 6 children. Sergeant O'Grady's youngest child was only 5 months old when he was murdered. By reducing a lawfully imposed sentence and the line of duty death of 2 police officers, we feel we've been insulted, not only along with Officer Brown and Sergeant O'Grady and their personal family members, but to all of our fellow members of law enforcement. Governor Cuomo's decision to commute this sentence appears to have been done with another agenda. It does not seem like he actually obtained a clear understanding of the facts of this case prior to making the decision. It doesn't seem possible that he would have made this decision to reduce the sentence by less than half if he was fully aware of the heinous crimes and the details that were committed by inmate Clark and her associates, or the resulting effect to the family and friends of the victims in this case. Again, I thank the members of the legislature for the opportunity to address you today. I thank you for having this on your agenda, and I'm here to offer the complete support on behalf of the Police Chiefs Association of Orange County in favor of this resolution. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief Dollinger. Resolution A1. You want to speak on A1? There is a typo under December 30th. Should be changed. 2016. Okay. Make that note. That will be changed. Legislator O'Donnell.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Sheriff. Thank you, Chiefs. Thank you all law enforcement for coming here this afternoon. I'm not sure where I was on October 20th, 1981, as a sergeant with the New York State Police assigned to the Thruway, but I can tell you where I was at 5 o'clock in the morning on October 21st, 1981. I was shoulder to shoulder with 100 plus other law enforcement agency members walking foot by foot, step by step through the woods, looking for the rest of these terrorists that did this heinous act, taking the lives of a Brink security guard and 2 dedicated law enforcement officers. Now, how many years later? 35 years later, we're discussing this same crime again, which is a disgrace. She belongs in jail. She should stay in jail. She should die in jail. She was reaching under the seat. There's more than the witness of Chief Alan Colsey stating that she was reaching under the seat looking for a weapon to continue this murderous, heinous crime. Let me just speak for a second about what the families feel like, because I can speak firsthand to that. In December 14, 1975, my best friend was killed in the line of duty. He was married to my sister Helen, right? My sister Helen was 5 months pregnant at the time, okay? Fortunately for my sister Helen and myself and the rest of our families, the person that killed Trooper McDonough was subsequently killed within a half hour after that, with the troopers responding to Sugarloaf, to the scene. I just cannot even fathom what the families are going through today, thinking that this woman is getting out of jail. I just can't imagine what I would be thinking, or my sister would be thinking, or my niece that was born 4 months later, or her 2 sons, right? 10 and 12 years old now, missing their grandfather, never seeing their grandfather. I can't imagine what they would be thinking of if the killer of their grandfather was getting out of jail. I just cannot even put it into proper words. I will be voting a resounding yes on this, and I will also be bringing a resolution next month to rename the new Tappan Zee Bridge in memory and in honor of these three brave men. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you. Any other comments? Yes, Legislator Ricas.
Thank you again, Mr. Chairman. I will be voting for this, but I just have one question that just has haunted me since this issue came up. And that question is, and maybe we can talk about it sometime, when does imprisonment become strictly punitive, and when does it become restorative or rehabilitative? I don't know. And I'm not going to make a judgment on this one issue, but I think it's something that we should all think about. Thank you.
Yes, Legislator, our Minority Leader Turner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, I'm a little disappointed that this came up as a consent resolution. I think there are instances where consent resolutions are justified. I think resolutions like this that require us to do a lot of research, find out exactly what the facts are. It's important for it to go through the process and give legislators the time to look into, you know, what this is a very, I wouldn't say call it complicated, but it's a long story. Many years have gone by since the event occurred. One prior instance, I was alone, no vote on the casinos. After the vote, I went up to a meeting up in the town of Newburgh, and somebody said to me, who was the idiot that voted against the casinos? And I said, gee, I don't remember, some idiot, you know. Well, again, you know, I did my research on this. I looked into it, because if a governor of a state makes a decision to do something, there's usually a pretty good reason. I know I'm going to get labeled soft on crime, anti-cop. I have police officers in my family. That just isn't true. I think that I'm comfortable in voting against this resolution for a long list of reasons. Now, I do agree that when a police officer is killed, it's different than when somebody else gets killed, because it's an attack on our system. I also agree that if somebody is part of a group that commits a crime and there's a murder, it's just like they pulled the trigger. I'm not opposed to that. However, I think they are factors. So some of the facts surrounding this case is that ones that actually pulled the trigger are already out of prison. Commuting the sentence to 35 years makes Clark available for parole. Doesn't mean she's going to get paroled. In fact, I'd be surprised if she did get paroled on the first attempt. Some of the victims in this crime are urging mercy and support what the government is doing. I think one of the things that's most significant is that the people closest to the situation, those that work at the prison, those on the parole board, are generally speaking unified in supporting the governor's decision, and in fact were instrumental in the governor making that decision. I read an article by Tom Robbins in the New York Times. I really liked the article because it really didn't take a side. It just talked about a lot of the things that have happened over the years, a lot of the things that Clark has said, a lot of the things that Clark has done. You know, I kind of see this as a person who was a devil, did an incredibly horrendous, involved in an incredibly horrendous crime. But the atonement, the retribution, and the transition to the person she is today is beyond impressive. At the time of the crime, she had an 11-month daughter, and that was kind of a thing that really affected me, because there was, at least by her own account, she was torn between being this radical and being a mother. I can go on and on, I'll spare you that, but I have to believe that I'm a reasonable person, and I think if anybody had done the amount of research that I've done on this particular issue, many of them would come to the same conclusion. In the end, I'd just like to mention, maybe I'm a little bit different because I'm a person that has, you know, I didn't commit any horrendous crimes, but I kind of have a history that parallels this. I'm a person that benefited from forgiveness. I wouldn't be here today if people hadn't supported me and forgave me for a lot of my craziness when I was young. So I'll be voting no.
I don't know how much more research we could have done on this topic, Matt, to be honest with you. I mean, to me, it's as black and as white can be. It's a simple ethical question. What this woman was involved with and what she did to those families and their, you know, it's indescribable. I mean, it's terrible. And I felt it was that important to bring this as a consent today. I mean, you hear me bemoan some of Andrew Cuomo's policies and edicts that he sends down to the counties. You know, just for example, free tuition, you know, legislator Nagastakis, you're right. There ain't no such thing as a free lunch, whichever economist said it. And that was insulting. The SAFE Act, another one that he sent down to us without any way to pay for it for the counties. The Sheriff's Department, this onslaught of gun permits, health and mental health issues that we have to deal with in the county, and so many other issues that he set down. The one that I really ticked me off was the Startup New York, you know, which was a complete insult to anybody that's been in business for many years. I paid taxes in this state for many years. But those are other issues. But this is an ethical issue, a moral issue. You know, I heard Andrew Cuomo, last year he said, oh, we love upstate New York. Well, upstate New York doesn't love you. Maybe Sullivan County a little bit, but upstate, and they're going to love you less after this commutation of Judith Clark's sentence. It's a complete insult. It really is. It's not just another free giveaway in the Andrew Cuomo sweepstakes. This hit close to home. Rockland County, Orange County. Sheriff Du Bois was a police officer in the city of Middletown. My neighbor was there at the trial, Chief of the Village of Goshen, Jimmy Watt. Jim O'Donnell was a sergeant in the state police. They saw this. They vividly remember this incident. And I remember it. I was a young adult. I think I was about 10 years old. No, I'm sorry. I was a young adult, but I was older than that. But it just really rubbed salt on a raw spot that he could even consider commuting her sentence after what she did to those families or helped do to those families. It's a terrible, heinous crime. And God forbid if that happened to us. She's not reformed. She deserves to stay where she is. I encourage you to vote for this today. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
No.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis?
Yes.
Benton?
Yes.
Berkman?
Yes.
Benelli?
Yes.
Cheney?
Yes.
DeSalvo?
Yes.
Ekis? Fagione?
Yes.
Hines?
Yes.
Hemnins?
Yes.
Kulisek?
Yes.
O'Donnell?
Yes.
Padu?
Yes.
Ruskevich?
Yes.
Sullivan?
Yes.
Bureau?
Yes.
Brescia?
Yes.
19 ayes, 1 no.
Okay, 1 is withdrawn, number 2.
Legislators says Benelli, Amo, Bonasek, DeSalvo, Fagione, Hines.
Thank you again for coming, gentlemen. Sorry.
Kulisek and Chemnitz. Resolution recognizing February as Black History Awareness Month.
Second.
Discussion. All Republicans are added. Matt. All Democrats, you mean? Okay. And Independents, Michael? Yeah, okay.
Bonnetec, Turnbull, Amo, Anagnestakis, Benton, Berkman, Benelli, Cheney, DeSalvo, Ickes, Fagion, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, O'Donnell, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Brescia, 20 ayes.
Okay, number three, bond resolution requiring 2/3 votes.
Legislators Benelli, Turnbull, Benton, DeSalvo. Bond resolution dated February 2nd, 2017. Bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing the expansion of the Heritage Trail, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $375,000, appropriating said amount therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $375,000 bonds of the county to finance said appropriation.
Second.
Discussion?
All Dems.
All Dems. Okay. Yes, Legislator DeSalvo.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to say glad to see this coming forward. I know the folks in Harriman really appreciate it. I think it's very important as we continue the trail in the Middletown area that we remembered the Harriman area and where it starts, and I'm glad to see this moving forward. I want to thank the County Executive's Office and the legislature. Hopefully, I'm sure this is going to pass. Thanks.
Thank you. Welcome.
Turnbull,
yes.
Amo,
yes.
Anagnestakis, Benton, Berkman, Benelli, Cheney, DeSalvo, Ickes, Fagion, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, O'Donnell, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Brescia, 20 ayes.
Okay, number four.
Legislators Turnbull, Riskevich, Benton, and Kulisek. Bond resolution dated February 2nd, 2017. Bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing the acquisition of building equipment at various Orange County locations, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $100,000, appropriating said amount therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $100,000 bonds of the county to finance said appropriation.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonnetec?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli, Cheney, DeSalvo, Ickes, Fagion, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, O'Donnell, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Brescia, 20 ayes.
Okay, number five, another bond resolution.
Legislators Benelli, Turnbull, Benton, Hines. Bond resolution dated February 2nd, 2017. Bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing the construction of building capital improvements at various county locations, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $350,000, appropriating said amount therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $350,000 bonds of the county to finance said appropriation.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonnetec?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Brescia, 20 ayes.
And number six.
Legislators Turnbull, Riskevich, Benton, Hines. Bond resolution dated February 2nd, 2017. Bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing the partial reconstruction of various county roads, strength paving, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $1,300,000, appropriating said amount therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $1,300,000 bonds of the county to finance said appropriation.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonnetec?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Brescia? 20 ayes.
Okay, number seven.
Legislators Riskevich, Kulisek, Benton, O'Donnell. Amending bond resolution dated February 2nd, 2017. Bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, amending the bond resolution adopted April 5th, 2013 in relation to financing the cost of replacement of the Stony Ford Bridge located in the towns of Hamptonburg and Walk Hill at the total estimated cost of $1,740,000.
Second.
Discussion? Yes.
My name on that, please.
Yeah, Matt's going to be added. Okay. Yes. Mike's going to be added. Okay, roll call.
Bonnetec?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo.
Yes.
Anagostakis. Benton. Berkman. Benelli. Cheney. DeSalvo. Ickes. Fagion. Hines. Chemnitz. Kulisek. O'Donnell. Paduk. Riskevich. Sullivan. Vero. Bresch. 20 ayes.
Okay, number 8.
Legislators Vero, Kulisek, Benton, Benelli. Bond resolution dated February 2nd, 2017. Bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing the construction of a bulk hangar at the county airport, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $980,000, appropriating said amount therefore, including the $882,000 expected to be received from the state of New York, and authorizing the issuance of 98,000 bonds of the county to finance the balance of said appropriation.
Second.
Discussion. I will say that this is going to be one of the recommendations that come out of the airport committee that John Vero chairs and Jim O'Donnell sits on. I also sit at ex officio, so they beat you to the gun on this one, I guess.
That's okay.
But
grant money, we want to accept
it. Absolutely. Okay, roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Nagnostakis?
No.
Benton? Berkman?
No.
Benelli? Cheney? DeSalvo?
No.
Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Bresch. 17 ayes, 3 noes.
And Legislator DeSalvo sits on that committee as well. Okay, number 9.
Legislator Benton, resolution authorizing the county executive to enter into an agreement with certain Orange County municipalities providing for the exemption from county taxation of lands owned and used by them for water supply and related purposes pursuant to section 4063 of real property tax law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, O'Donnell, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Bresch, 20 ayes.
And number 10.
Legislators Benton, Berkman. Resolution authorizing the private sale and conveyance of certain county-owned lands acquired by reason of a failure to redeem said lands from a tax sale to Orange County pursuant to section 10184 of the real property tax law and Orange County amended local law number 2 of 2010.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek? Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Bresch. 20 ayes.
Earl 11, I'm sorry.
Legislator Benton, resolution approving the applications for the correction of certain errors appearing on the 2017 tax rolls for certain towns and districts and ordering the correction of said errors pursuant to section 554 of the real property tax law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Bresch, 20 ayes.
Number 12.
Legislator Benton, resolution approving the applications for the correction of certain errors appearing on the 2017 tax rolls for certain towns and districts and ordering the correction of said errors pursuant to section 554 of the real property tax law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis, Benton, Berkman, Benelli, Cheney, DeSalvo, Ickes, Fagion, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, O'Donnell, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Bresch, 20 ayes.
Okay, number 13.
Legislator Benton, resolution approving the applications for the correction of certain errors appearing on the 2017 tax rolls for certain towns and districts and ordering the correction of said errors pursuant to section 554 of real property tax law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Bresch. 20 ayes.
14.
Legislator Benton, resolution approving the applications for the correction of certain errors appearing on the 2017 tax rolls for certain towns and districts and ordering the correction of said errors pursuant to section 554 of the real property tax law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Nagustakis, Benton, Berkman, Benelli, Cheney, DeSalvo, Ekis, Fagion, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, O'Donnell, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Brescia, 20 ayes.
Okay, number 15.
Legislator Benton, resolution approving the applications for the correction of certain errors appearing on the 2017 tax rolls for certain towns and districts and ordering the correction of said errors pursuant to Section 554 of the real property tax law.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacek.
Yes.
Turnbull.
Yes.
Amo.
Yes.
Anagnostakis. Benton. Berkman. Benelli. Cheney. DeSalvo. Ekis. Fagion. Hines. Chemnitz. Kulisek. O'Donnell. Paduk. Riskevich. Sullivan. Vero. Brescia. 20 ayes.
And number 16.
Legislator Benton, resolution approving the application for the correction of certain errors appearing on the 2017 tax rolls for certain towns and districts and ordering the correction of said errors pursuant to Section 554 of the real property tax law.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacek.
Yes.
Turnbull.
Yes.
Amo.
Yes.
Anagnostakis. Benton. Berkman. Benelli. Cheney. DeSalvo. Ekis. Fagion. Hines. Chemnitz. Kulisek. O'Donnell. Paduk. Riskevich. Sullivan. Vero. Brescia. 20 ayes.
Okay, number 17.
Legislators DeSalvo and Fagion, resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County District Attorney's Office to submit an application for the Gun Involved Violence Elimination GIV grant from New York State Division of Criminal Justice Services.
Second.
Discussion? Yep. You want to be added, Jim? Jim Kulisek, all Dems? Okay. All Republicans? Okay. Michael?
Yep.
Okay, everybody. Okay, roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yep.
Anagnostakis, Benton, Berkman, Benelli, Cheney, DeSalvo, Ekis, Fagion, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, O'Donnell, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Brescia, 20 ayes.
And number 18.
Legislator Sullivan and Chemnitz, resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County Department of Health to accept and appropriate grant funds from the New York State Department of Health pursuant to Section 99-H of General Municipal Law and Section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? All Democrats? Okay. Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Brescia? 20 ayes.
And number 19.
Legislator Sullivan and Chemnitz, resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County Department of Mental Health to accept and appropriate grant funds from the New York State Office of Mental Health pursuant to Section 99-H of the General Municipal Law and Section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Fagiona? Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Brescia? 20 ayes.
All Democrats on that one. Jane, please. All right, number 20.
Chairman Brescia, resolution appointing the members of Labor Relations Advisory Committee pursuant to Article 4, Section G of the Legislative Manual.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Brescia, 20 ayes.
Okay, number 21.
Chairman Brescia, resolution appointing the members of the Orange County Economic Development and Gaming Committee pursuant to Article 4, Section G of the Legislative Manual.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagion? Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, O'Donnell, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Brescia. 20 ayes, Mr. Chairman, and the desk is clear.
Okay, we're just ready for the speakers after the meeting. Okay, I will say that I left a sheet, or the clerk left a sheet at the front there. It gives you the makeup of the legislative statutory committees, just for information, if anybody from the public, because I think a couple of you want to speak about that. Republicans make up about 57% of this legislature, Democrats 38%, and Michael, you're about 4.75% or so, 5%, so, okay. Just so you see the composite of each committee and what the percentage of each are on the respective committees. Okay, first up to speak, I guess, Jerry, were you finished, or are you going first? You know, you didn't really get to say your whole speech. You want to, any more to say or no?
Yeah, I
Okay, come on up. And then I'll go to Dan Burke, I'm sorry. But Jerry was, okay.
Thank you. I wasn't saying any more on the committee makeup. What I wanted to speak about was the, and I apologize because I didn't get a chance to come for the public hearing on the raising the smoking age. And, you know, I think it's a great thing, but what I wanted to ask is whether you were, since it originated as an initiative in the legislature, that's why I'm coming to you, to see what you're doing as a follow-up. Are you doing anything educational? Are we doing any extra cessation prevention? Are we doing, I mean, I quit smoking the year the Jets won the Super Bowl. It's a little while ago.
Yeah, I think so.
That was my
second. Joe Namath's guarantee, right?
That was the second time, yes.
You that guaranteed you were gonna stop smoking too, right?
No, I stopped smoking the year before and then a friend of mine passed away and I started smoking again, but then I quit. Working out, doing a lot of working on the heavy bag with a cigarette in my mouth. It was stupid. But it's one of the great things we've done as a country, as a culture, is turn that around. My dad used to tell me what that black goo in people's lungs looked like and during autopsies. And he hated my smoking. And you know, I finally understood why. My grandfather quit smoking. He chain smoked Camels till he was in his mid-70s. And he quit because they raised the price of a pack of cigarettes from 20 cents to 25 cents. And he said, that's it. Most people can't do that. And we have 18, 19, 20 year olds who are now not gonna be able to buy cigarettes. They're gonna need help. I mean, I'm sure they'll go across the border, they'll go to Sullivan County, but as that changes. And I'm just concerned that And I don't know what kind of programs we have. I know we did have some pretty good programs, but I'm not sure if we've thought about that. And if we'll do any informational campaign like you've done with the social host law and other things to let people know that if they need help to quit smoking rather than going someplace else to get cigarettes. You know, we had when the tobacco companies in that huge settlement, all that money was supposed to go for prevention and supposed to go for helping people to quit smoking, and we know it mostly went into general budgets and such, but some of it was used and some of it was effective. So I just hope as a county that we will do our best to help people to really kick the habit. It's one of the best things that we have done as a county.
Okay. I don't usually respond to speakers, but I'm sure there'll be follow-up at the Health and Mental Health Committee, and if you have concerns, you can certainly talk to Chairman Anagnostakis about your concerns, and he can put it on his agenda. We saw the statistics ahead of time at the Health and Mental Health, which persuaded some of us strongly.
What did you say, Anthony?
Chris Erickson, the Commissioner of Health. Deputy Commissioner, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
And they have a lot of programs.
Okay. Thank you, Eric.
Thank you, Jerry. Okay, Dan. Dan Burke, Monroe, private citizen.
Hey, thank you. I'd say amend to what Jerry said. Anything we can do to reduce the use of tobacco and save some lives, so we should do it. So thank you for passing that resolution to change the age. I saw 14 items from the Ways and Means Committee. I said, that's on the agenda, so maybe I could talk about the composition of the Ways and Means Committee. However, I don't mind letting you know now instead of before the meeting. In Washington, Steve Bannon told the media to shut their mouths. Here in Orange County, the chairman of the legislature does not appoint two Democratic committee members because they ask too many questions. In effect, asking them to shut their mouths. An elected official, when once in office, has to represent all his constituents, the people who voted for him and the people who didn't vote for him. The Orange County legislature must represent all the citizens of Orange County. The legislature cannot do this if minority members are being told to shut up. The 75,000 Democratic voters in Orange County are in effect being told to shut up also. 1,495 voters and the chairman's district did not vote for the chair in 2013, they also must now shut up. So what we need is more people to speak up, and we should be encouraging this. And we can listen, we can handle it. I'd like to see more, not less. All right, thank you.
Okay, next speaker is Mary Ann McDonough from Otisville.
Speak truth to power. Power in this case is the newly re-elected chairman of the Orange County Legislature, Steve Brescia. I have read three letters to the editor of the Times Herald Record that have done exactly that, spoken truth to power. In addition, the Times Herald Record editorial of January 23rd gives jeers to Chairman Brescia for abusing his power. Since I was not able to attend the 1-5-17 Orange County Legislative Reorganization meeting, it was through the Frey article by Chris McKenna and other newspaper coverage that I've already cited that I became informed of Chairman Brescia's abuse of power. Since then, I viewed online the YouTube video of January 5th meeting, reorg meeting. This video shows Chairman Brescia identifying his agenda for 2017 legislative session. He informed his fellow legislators that a lot of questions were delaying things at the statutory meetings. He stated he was going to be aggressive in 2017 and not allow delays that came with too many questions. Brescia also chastised those legislators who were spending too much time analyzing the budget. He specifically stated legislators are not to be experts on the budget. Instead, he instructed legislators to trust their department heads and commissioners. According to Chairman Brescia, legislators should only be concerned with, quote, the conceptual things of the county budget. When I examined the Orange County Legislative Handbook for Functions of the Legislature, section 1.1 of the primary functions is to adopt an annual budget. How can a legislature do this without thorough analysis, begs asking. We've already had a major example when the Orange County Legislature trusted the Valley View figures of former Valley View Administrator William Pascicello and former County Executive Ed Diana. The results were disastrous and most of all untrue. Remember, Valley View was going to cost $30 million in county tax dollars. It almost led to a closing of a much-loved and much-respected health facility. The legislators and the chair of the Orange County Legislature are not elected to be paid to trust the department heads for work for the county executive. Somehow, Chairman Brescia is not familiar with the Orange County Legislature's handbook, section 2.1, which states the major responsibility of a county legislator is to act on and behalf of all of its residents in dealing with the affairs of the government in the county. What I find unconscionable is that Matt Turnbull, Ways and Means, and Jeff Bergman rules, according to the Times Herald Record, were removed from their respective committees by Brescia for, quote, asking too many questions and being too partisan. This reeks of political retaliation and is certainly not mature professional conduct for the Orange County Legislative Chair. The Times Herald Record has also correctly identified the lack of democracy that's taking place when Brescia sets his goal of passing his and his party's agenda with little debate and fewer changes, quote unquote. Orange County residents do not elect and pay salaries of 20 legislators to have them rubber stamp the county executive and the chair of the legislature. Instead, Orange County voters and taxpayers expect democracy to be taking place within county government. This includes, but is not limited to, reviews, debates, analyses, investigations, and yes, even many questions. We do not expect and will not tolerate our legislators to be retaliated against. I want to thank the three people that wrote letters to the editor. I want to thank the Times Herald editorial board. I'm rushing to finish. Thank you for giving me a few extra seconds. Let us hope by speaking truth to power in 2017 that the legislative agenda will provide for democracy at its best and stop the bullying and reprisal that we've already experienced. Thank you.
Okay. Mary Lou Dietrich, excuse me, Middletown. Representation on committees.
Hi, I wanted to just respond to the article in the Times Herald Record as well. I acknowledge that the legislative chairman traditionally have been granted the assignment of appointing committee members to respective assignments in the Orange County Legislature. This assignment should not entail blocking the representation of those who have elected the county representative they feel is best for their community. Mr. Brescia has removed two of our elected Orange County representatives, one from the Ways and Means and one from the Rules Committee. He has removed the primary representative of our second largest city and a person who has served those representatives well for more than a decade. By asking too many questions and bogging down meetings, Mr. Berkman is assuring that every decision is not simply a rubber stamp of what the government of Orange County is trying to pass through committees to advance their platform. As a member of Mr. Berkman's district, I want him to question the proposed new laws, the manner in which county funds are spent, and to receive detailed explanations related to every decision that is forwarded to the full legislation. If the Democrats make up about 38% of the legislation, I'm surprised that there are no chairs of any committee from the Democrats. If Mr. Berkman and Mr. Turnbull are blocked from a seat on these committees, perhaps residents of the 11th and 20th districts, Middletown, Washingtonville, Town of Blooming Grove, and New Windsor, who are being denied representation, should attend those meetings to observe what is being decided and how the meetings are conducted.
Okay, Emily Conyers, regarding the meeting of North Monroe.
Good afternoon. How much time do I have? Okay, I timed this, it's 3 minutes, 16 seconds, so I hope you'll forgive me.
Let's go a little longer, Marianne, we're over.
Can I raise this a little bit? Okay. Well, good afternoon, county legislators, Chairman Brescia. I'm Emily Convair, chairwoman of United Monroe, and I am here today to urge you to include the leadership of United Monroe in any meetings or discussions regarding KJ's petition to form the town of North Monroe. I want to address Chairman Brescia's comments to the Times Herald Record, in which he states that he would disallow leaders of United Monroe from attending an initial meeting to discuss the formation of North Monroe. The Times Herald Record stated that Brescia replied that he wanted to meet initially with government representatives only to seek middle ground, and that United Monroe could convey its views through the two Monroe councilmen and legislator Myrna Chemnitz of Monroe. While we respect legislator Chemnitz, she does not speak for United Monroe, and by virtue of the Monroe Town Board's yes vote on the 164-acre annexation, the town board is on the opposite side of a lawsuit from the citizens of Monroe who primarily oppose the KJ annexation efforts. Chairman Brescia stated he wants to hold this meeting to see if they might be able to find, quote, middle ground on the terms for forming a new town that would be broadly acceptable to Monroe voters. I can assure the legislature that no one knows what is acceptable to Monroe voters more than the leaders of the organization who have won the trust and support of 98% of the voters in Monroe outside of Curious Joel in the last three town elections. United Monroe boasts hundreds of volunteers and thousands of supporters. United Monroe has garnered over 8,000 votes townwide in the last town council election and over 9,000 votes countywide in the 2014 assembly race. I don't know how great voter turnout is in your communities in local non-presidential elections, but in Monroe, we get over 60% of voters. It's frankly unprecedented. Lastly, I want to share with you an email the KJ administrator, Gedalia Segedin, sent to me on July 9th of 2014, only 6 months after the 507-acre annexation petition was filed. Gedalia states, "Let me pose a question to you on behalf of my board. If a proposal to split the town of Monroe into two separate towns or to form a city of KJ by using the New York 17 as the dividing line of the town of Monroe and the new town or city, and making the New York 17 as the permanent buffer between the two municipalities is proposed in a formal manner, can you and your group support it? Can United Monroe endorse and support this new concept in a public referendum when the referendum day comes? If your answer is yes, we may be prepared to start this process. Sincerely, Gedalia." If Gedalia Segedin understood in 2014 that United Monroe's cooperation was necessary for any boundary shift to take place then, why would it be any different today? I urge Chairman Brescia and the county legislature to resolve to include the leadership of United Monroe in any and all further discussions with the leadership of Curious Joel regarding any potential formation of a new town or city. Excluding us would be damaging to the very vocal, very informed, and very engaged citizens of Monroe. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Final speaker, John Allegro, regarding the town of North Monroe.
Thank you all for allowing me to speak today. My name is John Allegro. I'm a United Monroe Executive Committee member and a founding board member of Preserve Hudson Valley. That's a 501c3 organization that is currently litigating an appeal against Curious Joel's 164-acre annexation. I wish to speak to you today in response to Chairman Brush's comments in a recent Times Herald Record article. In it, he states that he wants to meet with Monroe and Curious Joel leaders to find, quote, middle ground on the formation of the proposed town of North Monroe. This meeting would include county legislators, two Monroe councilmen, and Curious Joel's administrator, Gedalia Segeda. Mr. Brescher rejected two of our requests to participate in the meeting without reason. The issues of Curious Joel annexation and the proposed town of North Monroe are inextricably intertwined. The former is tied up in a court appeal. The latter is a plan B designed to circumvent the annexation appeal in which Preserve Hudson Valley and I am personally named as a petitioner in that case. Any attempt to mediate a middle ground should be called what it is, a negotiation for an out-of-court settlement. Mr. Brush's objective of finding, quote, broadly acceptable terms for a new town cannot be achieved without the participation of all parties involved in the annexation lawsuits in any and all meetings. This includes the leaders of Preserve Hudson Valley, again, in any and all meetings. As one of the leaders of United Monroe, I helped mobilize over 6,000 voters in three consecutive Monroe town elections and 9,000 voters in the 2014 New York State Assembly race. The Preserve Hudson Valley Board, which I am a member of, are the direct representatives of the people who contributed over $100,000 to fund the citizens' side of the Curious Joel annexation litigation. We deserve a seat at any negotiation that could result in an out-of-court settlement on the matter of KJ annexation, beginning, middle, to end. To leave us out of this process gives the appearance of unfair election year dealing between our county leadership and the Curious Joel government. Thank you.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn. Okay, yes. What do you want to say now?
Say it when I say it.
Is this going to be another political speech like the last meeting? I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Adjourned.